Today I'm with Lee Coit at the Unity Church on the North Shore. Today is September 25th, 1993. Lee is the author of two books, Listening and Listening Still. I want to welcome you, Lee, to The Light at Night. How are you? Thank you.
Fine.
I know you're on the road and you're on a tour. And I think we're really fortunate to be able to have this interview in between your some of your busy stops and so forth. I know you're off to Michigan next, aren't you?
Michigan next, yeah. A little round-the-country tour.
And I did your workshop, I think it was about 3 years ago, right here at this location. And I wanted to say, I think it had some impact, even though over the years, you know, the book got filed somewhere and so forth. When I heard you were here, I jumped at the chance to do this interview. And reviewing the book a few minutes ago, I noticed that the first chapter is called The Secret of the Inner Voice. And I don't know if you know this or not, but about 2 years ago almost, my sister and I started a magazine called, guess what, The Inner Voice.
Well, then you know the secret.
So it must have sunk in. Something happened, and you inspired a magazine title. And when I thought of that title, I thought I came up with it, you know, as kind of a reference to, a veiled reference to the Village Voice magazine out of New York. Kind of the opposite, you know, end of the spectrum, because the Village Voice is very much into mass consciousness, of course. And we're talking about something totally different. So thank you for that, Lee. And we wanted to talk about your experience, a little bit about your background and how you came to this inner listening process. Fill us in a little bit about your general background.
The short answer is through pain and suffering. I don't think we have to get there that way, but it seems like most of us
do.
Yeah,
that's true.
It's because we're pretty stubborn. And we need to go through a period in our life where we're have a chance to see if we can do it on our own. So whether it's right out of school or wherever, sometime in our life we take off with our own abilities and we go out in the world and we see what we can do. And then something happens. Either either there's failure or success. Either we achieve what we want or we don't achieve what we want. It doesn't make a lot of difference. But the end result of that is that after we've achieved or haven't achieved, we find out we still haven't got what we're looking for. And that's about what happened to me.
That sounds very Eastern, very Zen.
Does it? Oh, well, I've been accused of being Zen. I don't think I am. I've talked to Buddhists, and they think I am Buddhist. And I've talked with Sufis. They think I'm a Sufi. I think these are universal truths, really. It's a life experience. I mean, it's something, you know, billions of people go through. It's not just for one person. For me, it took the form of quite a successful advertising agency. Which I sold and thought I would go and do it right. After I sold it, the agency had become quite large, and I didn't like all the people problems that I had, and so I wanted to have a small little agency that just a few people, I could avoid those problems and really enjoy the creative part rather than the administrative part. So I tried that for about a year, and I was right back in the same soup again, and realized that I had two choices. I was about 40 years old. Either I could continue just doing this over and over again, starting a business or doing something to try to find happiness, or maybe there was another way. And so I took a year out. I was fortunate that from the sale I had enough money to not work for a year. I'd also gone through a divorce, which was personally devastating to me. And I just took a year out to see if I could find some answers, you know, what's life and what's it all about. I actually started out, Steve, to prove there wasn't a God, because I thought my problem was that there was this religious background in my life that if you're a good person, you do good things, you're going to get rewarded. My experience was much the opposite, that no good deed was left unpunished, that good guys do finish last, not first. And that bothered me a lot. I couldn't really decide to be a bad guy because I still had doubts there might be some punishment out there if I was, and yet I wasn't finding that the old truths I'd learned as a child were really working, and I really wanted some answers before I proceeded. So I set out to prove there wasn't a God. I thought if I could prove there was no God, there would be no punishment, then I could get on and do life the way I wanted. Unfortunately, or fortunately, whichever way you want to look at it, what I found was that there is a power. You can think of it as a power or principles or whatever, but there is a force. There is an overriding pattern to things, and we can't avoid it, and we need to be in harmony with it and listen to it. So that's where the listening came
in. Well, I'd be curious as to what sort of experience, maybe something in particular, helped you realize that there was a God. There was something.
Well, what I did specifically was I was living in Laguna Beach, and I decided that I didn't know how I'd find God, so God was going to have to find me, if there was a God. And so I said, I'll give you a year, and I'll sit on this rock. I found a rock by the ocean that I really liked. I would run down there in the morning and sit on the rock and wait for an hour or two for something to happen. And then I'd go home. And during the day also, I'd be, you know, waiting for something to happen. So I became very sensitive to events and thoughts that were coming to me and so forth. In the beginning, there were just thoughts occurring to me, thoughts that I would not have generated myself, or at least I didn't think I would have generated them myself. One of the first ones that comes to mind, I was walking along the beach after sitting on the rock, and I saw some plastic and rope and stuff, and I thought, oh, it's terrible that man is really fouling up his world. And then this thought came that it didn't make any difference, and I thought, that's a strange. Why doesn't it make any difference? And the thought continued, well, man has a choice to either have a nice place to live or to foul it. It's totally within his own choice. And if he decides to foul it, it will just end. And life will start on another planet or be, you know, continue on another planet. And I really had kind of a little vision. There's two creatures, kind of long green arms, were sitting, you know, with their arms around each other, watching the sky on some planet somewhere. I don't know where it was. And one said to the other, oh, look, dear, a falling star. Of course, it was Earth going out in a blaze of pollution. And they both thought, oh, isn't that beautiful? You know, and it really doesn't make any difference on the grand scale. And that was a startling little vision. Uh-huh. And those things started continuing because I was looking for them. And as it went along, they became very coincidental until ultimately I was on a pier totally alone, and a voice behind me said, you've come this far, what are you afraid of, in reference to going to this particular place. And I turned around, there was no one there. and so at that point I kind of gave up and realized there was something out there of which I did not have control, and it was not my own mental concoction.
This was a loud voice.
It was a loud voice. Yeah, just as you and I are talking now. Like in fact, a little louder.
Did it have this echo?
No, it didn't have an echo. It did have a rather, as I remember it, it's hard to remember these things accurately because a lot of it is just the emotional feeling of it. It did have rather an authoritative feeling to it. Interestingly enough, my reaction at that point was, because I'm very much a doubter and very much a tester. In fact, this whole thing I'm doing is really an experiment.
You were an atheist. Is that right?
No, I was not an atheist. I was certainly a disbeliever until it. I was at least a doubting Thomas, if not worse. I want to actually see it work. I don't believe in theory. I like to see.
You weren't practicing any religion?
No.
At all. You're pretty much mainstream.
Going to church or
yuppie,
anything.
That kind of thing.
Somewhere in that area, yeah. I viewed myself a little more rugged than the BMW.
So you had the Land
Abercrombie and Fitch,
something like that, a Jeep.
Yeah, something a little more, a little scruffier, I think.
Yeah, in this area, that's very cool now.
That's cool now.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Sure.
Well, I was just 10 years too early, I guess.
You have to have the Jeep.
Anyway, my reaction to this voice was, I'm not afraid to go down there, I'll go down. You know, it was kind of confrontational, and my reaction was confrontational back. Well, you know, okay, I'll try it, I'm not afraid, you know. And I thought afterwards, that's probably the best way to get me to do anything, is to kind of dare me not
challenge.
To do it. Yeah, challenge me. And, of course, then I'll just,
you know,
sucker into it right away.
Where were you going?
That's how I ran into the Course in Miracles. I was, I'd read a little book by Jerry Jampolsky that mentioned the Course in Miracles, and I thought it was a stupid name. I really, anybody that's teaching how to do miracles, I mean, they must be very weird. And so I didn't want to go to find out more about it, I kind of crossed them off. I'd gone into a bookstore.
Is that Love is Letting Go of Fear?
Yes, Love is Letting Go of Fear.
A lot of people have read that.
And in fact, this the pier is where Jerry's office is where I was. And I had gone into a bookstore and got his book a couple of weeks earlier, and I was back buying more books from my friends. Mm-hmm. And I asked about The Course in Miracles, and they said they were all out. I was very glad they were all out, because I felt it was a sign that I wasn't supposed to proceed with it, you see. And I didn't like the name. I envisioned these people in white robes dancing around candles and stuff. And I don't want to do that. I don't even like white robes. Yeah, chanting. I hate chanting.
The little symbols, right?
Oh, I'd much rather go down and drink beer. I think that God's down there too,
I
prefer drinking beer. But anyway, it was quite a challenge, and it was interesting when I got. The place where, this was in Tiburon, the place where they had the Course in Miracles was in this house, a very normal house. I knocked on the door, and on the way down I had decided if they tried to sign me up for anything or sell me anything, I was going to get out of there, leave. A guy came to the door in tennis clothes, Bob Scutch is his name, and Bob is Judy Scutch's ex-husband, and they are the people who didn't scribe the course but actually got it published. And Bob came out and said, "What do you want?" And I said, "Well, I want to look at the Course in Miracles books." And he said, "I haven't got time for that." Again, exactly the right approach for me.
Right.
Yeah. And I said, "Well, I'm not going to buy them unless I look at them." And it got confrontational. And he said, "Well, I got to go play tennis. I haven't got time to let you look at the books." So he handed me this package that I think he was going to mail it out. It was all like brown, wrapped in brown paper, kind of like you get a porno tape or something, you know. And he said, "It's $30. And I went, "That's a lot of books for $30. I've been paying $10 for a little tiny book. So I bought them on volume, weight, and good deal. Appealing to my Welsh nature. And so I bought them sight unseen. To finish the story, when I opened the package and read the manual, I knew it was the next step in a series of books that had been coming. And that whole period was a period of books and things coming to me, not from other people, but maybe on sale someplace. Or usually it wasn't the one I went to buy, it was the other one that fell in the bag along the way that was the really meaningful book. It was a whole period of searching and finding answers, and just kept building and building. It wasn't any one real event that kind of pushed me over the edge, I guess.
Approximately what year was that for you?
That was 1980, 79 and 80. Long time ago.
Well, you've been on some amazing experiences since then, and a lot of that is described in your first book, which is called Listening, and the subtitle is How to Increase Awareness of Your Inner Guide. With me today on location is Lee Coit, author of two books on listening, and the second book is Listening Still. Lee, I'd like to know a little bit more about the process of listening, and why do you call it listening versus, say, inner listening or something like that?
That question has never been asked before, Steve, and it's a good question. I'm not sure I know the answer, actually. The reason I call it listening is because that's what I was told to call it. Actually, it was given to me. That whole book was given to me.
What do you mean it was now, given to you? I mean, some people...
Well, I was... the book... When we were last talking about getting the Course in Miracles, and this is not a promotion of the Course in Miracles because there are many other paths. I'm not really here to promote that.
But
it just happened. That's what happened. It's great. Yeah. It just happened to be what was given to me. And it was an individual thing. I took it to Europe, and I spent 7 months just... there's a workbook in the Course in Miracles with a lesson every day, and I spent 7 months doing those lessons, pretty much as they're laid out. I was really nothing else to do. I was just doing that.
So this was right after your living on the beach experience?
Yes, right after I left it.
And listening on the rock and all of that?
All of that, yeah. When I got the Course in Miracles through the the little experience I related to you earlier, I decided that it was the next step in my process, and I wanted to do it fully. And I'd always wanted to go to Europe, and my son was now grown, who I'd been raising, and it was a time for me to take off. So I devoted 7 months to really following the Course in Miracles process, which I think, most people don't talk about that, but I really feel that the Course in Miracles is designed to help you get in touch with your inner guidance. I mean, I really think that is its sole purpose. And all the other things that people say to learn forgiveness or this, to learn about God or to reach awareness or whatever, mm-hmm. I think those are outcomes of that, because it's a very different process. Anyway, after I had done that, I came back. You were asking how the book came about. I came back and I was basically tricked into going out and talking to people, because I had taken pictures while I was in Europe, and people wanted to see my slides. And in the course of showing them the slides, I would talk about my experiences that I'd had while I was there. And that sort of got picked up by various groups, and they would invite me to come. And I sort of hid behind the slides for years. People would ask me to leave something, and I said, I can't, it's just a personal experience, I can't leave anything with you. Finally, I asked what I should be leaving, and the joke between myself and my inner guide, who we often have a dialogue with, is when all else fails, listen. So all else had failed, and I did listen, and he gave me some numbers of various lessons in the Course in Miracles, and said, take a weekend and go up in the mountains and just camp and read a lesson and then take an hour and meditate on it. Mm-hmm. When I did that, it was a two-day thing, when I did that and I would meditate, why, this information came through. I had this old typewriter, I was just typing as fast as I could. I really didn't know if it made sense or what it was. In fact, another person got the material that I'd been recording and actually put it in a book form, and then suggested that I add the stories to illustrate some of the points from my trip in Europe. So that's really how that book came about. And I asked what to call this process, and I heard listening. But when you say inner listening, I think that the reason it was listening, now that you asked that, and I've never really formulated this, is it's not just inner listening, it's not just meditation. When we're listening, we're really, it's more like a state of awareness, mm-hmm. a state of sensitivity. So there may actually be messages coming on a billboard. I had a great experience with a song, just to relate how that worked. I was, I'd been to a conference, I'd had some really internal turmoil over what had gone on, and I was driving back home in my van, and the tape deck was broken. The only thing that would work was the radio. And I turned it on, and I was out by Fresno, nothing but cowboy stations. And I like cowboy music, but it just wasn't what I wanted. I was trying to get calm and peaceful. And I wished I could play, you know, some nice symphony or something, sure. that would really calm me down. And all I was getting was the radio. And so I said, why can't I get something that will calm me down, really a question to the universe, and I heard, listen to what's on the radio. So I turned it up, and I listened, and it was Willie Nelson singing Live One Day at a Time. It was exactly what I needed to hear. It was just in a cowboy content. It was the whole message of the song was absolutely perfect for me. So it can be even actively listening, as in that case. It doesn't limit just to being in a meditative state or shutting your eyes. It's awareness of all the messages that are coming.
So this would seem to imply that we're really learning to listen to a larger intelligence that's totally surrounding, and we're immersed in it.
We're immersed in it.
And
it's like
totally
air.
Aware of everything, including what's on that radio station
exactly.
at that moment.
And it's like air. You know, it's the one thing we can't live without, but if you ask someone, what do you think you couldn't live without? They'll say, well, water or food. Actually, the air, we can only live for a few seconds without air, maybe a couple minutes, and yet we never think of it because it's so universal. That has been my experience as I've gone deeper and deeper into this process, Steve, that the more I'm willing to listen, or if you'd like the word, to be aware, to be conscious, to be present, to be in the moment. I really see the messages coming to me from many, many places.
Well, I'm very interested in making some distinctions here. And for example, the other night I went to listen to a guru who came to us all the way from India.
Uh-huh.
And to initiate people into the ancient path of Kriya Yoga. I won't say who it was, but he was really, in his lecture, it was kind of a spontaneous talk, and it lasted about an hour and a half. And during that time, he was really down on this, what he called channeling and ascension and all these New Age things. And we traced it back to, on the way here, someone had given him a book. So he read this book on ascension, which is very New Agey and so forth.
Yeah.
And of course, he's coming from a very parochial background in Benares or someplace like that. And what I'm getting from listening to you is that, and contrasting that with what he was saying, this Eastern thing, he's very solidly Eastern, and his grandfather was very famous.
Yeah.
That it sounded like he was trying to get us into a place of listening that would actually take us off the planet. You know, in other words, he was saying, don't try to use this to improve your life. Forget doing affirmations. Just do this process and listen. Get in touch with God.
It may be necessary at the beginning of the process to, in fact, I could almost say it is necessary, to formalize your meditation, to spend time in the morning, to really...
So that is
to really go inside and to be quiet, because there is so much distraction in the world that it's hard, unless you're quite attuned, to sort out the valuable from the not valuable. I'm not saying everything that comes to you is valuable, but I am saying there are messages out there that we're not hearing.
We're just not hearing, but they're there.
They're there, and they don't have to just come through meditation. In the beginning, meditation is probably one of the easier ways to get it. But I think as you sensitize yourself, as you realize that the messages are all over, then you can find them everywhere, on billboards, on radio stations, what other people are saying. That doesn't mean everything they're saying. But, in fact, I'm very suspicious when someone says, this is what you need to read, this is what you need to do. I seldom think that that's for me. But often something within the contents of what they're saying will just strike a chord within me. And that's really the test. It's not just is it coming to me, but does it resonate within me? Does that, on some level, pull itself above the crowd and is it meaningful to me? And if it is, if I'm attuned and it becomes meaningful, then it is a message for me. So it's a process of attunement, really, and sensitivity.
This is something you get into in your first book, Listening. And you describe your trip through Europe, and if I recall, you wouldn't even turn left or right. Unless you stopped long enough to hear that voice. And then you talk about the first voice and the second voice. Now, maybe you could help us with, maybe it's the word is discrimination.
Yes.
How do you know which voice to listen to? Because we hear a lot of things.
Almost to annihilate it before we answer the question, I would say it doesn't make that much difference. Because if you're listening to the right source, it's going to work. And if you're not listening to the right source, it won't work. So it's just a matter of as you go down the road, if you haven't been sensitive, you're going to find yourself in the wrong place, right? So it becomes, it's self-correcting. So first of all, I want to get rid of the idea that it's so important to hear the right voice, and if you don't, that something bad's going to happen. What really happens, the bad thing, is we become so positive that this is what we want to do that we force it when it's very obvious that we shouldn't be proceeding. You see what I'm saying?
So in other words, then maybe that's the time to slow down.
That's the time to stop. In other words, if you have listened to the wrong voice, if we want to use those terms, which are pretty simplified, if you've gotten your own personal desires in there and they're leading you astray, it's going to become evident as you go along. The amazing thing is how much pain most of us can stand before we're aware that we're on the wrong track. You know, we've got a relationship that's not working. It's obvious to everybody it's not working. In our quiet moments, it's obvious to us, and yet when we're with that person, we just keep going because we're afraid to be alone or whatever. And the pain just becomes more and more intense. So the pain itself is somewhat self-correcting.
It's a signal.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, even an amoeba, when it hits the wall, will make a right or left turn. I mean, we don't have to be terribly intelligent to realize something's wrong. But there are other ways. We don't have to just rely on pain. And we can start getting in touch with the voice that seems to resonate within us, the voice that makes us feel at peace. Often when I'm getting inner guidance, it will be like I'm struggling and struggling and struggling with something and I can't get clarity. And all of a sudden this thought will come and it's just like it clarifies the whole situation. That may sound very spiritual, but let me give you a very practical example. If you've ever lost your house keys or your car keys, misplaced them, you think and think and think, where did I put them? And you think about, you know, what was I wearing last and where did I hang it or did I throw them on the counter? But, well, some people still.
I know a few people who always lose their keys.
If you've had the experience, and so you think and think and think, where are they? And you come up with all these solutions and you go and look and it's not there, right? So finally you give up and you say, I don't know where they are. I'll just forget it. Invariably after that, the thought will come to you, oh, that's right, I left them there, I put them there, I left them in the car, whatever. When that thought comes, you don't have to go look. I mean, you know on another level that's the right one. It resonates. Yeah, that's where they are. And that's how it feels when you get guidance. When all the possibilities, one will come that really feels, that's right, that really clarifies it, that really puts me at peace, that really is the right direction. And that's how you tell, as you start getting more sensitive to that. Or you can run around the rest of your life looking for your car keys.
Well, we can talk about that and more details about the process when we come back.
You're listening to a timeless topic edition of the Expanding Light radio program. The guest is Lee Coit, author of the book Listening. Stay with us. We'll be right back. And we are back. This is Steve Fryer, and this is a Timeless Topic edition of the Expanding Light radio program. My guest is Lee Coit, author of the book Listening.
About a year ago, I met a man named Michael Rhodes, and I spent a few days with him. He seemed to come up with a very similar process and had written a book called Listening to Nature, Talking to Nature, things like that. And he would do the same process, it seemed. He'd go down to the river behind his farm in Australia on a daily basis, and he'd bring along a pad of paper and so forth, and he'd just sit there and listen. And after a while, he started hearing things. You know, he'd look at a little dragonfly or something like that, and he'd start to hear a dialogue going on between himself and the animal.
Yeah.
And some of the writings that came out were very beautiful.
Yeah.
And it sounds like this is kind of a universal possibility for all of us to access a deeper wisdom and actually be able to access different, maybe we could call it individualizations of the one mind.
Mm-hmm.
Does that sound accurate?
And, oh, yeah.
And how can you relate that to your own experience?
Well, we were speaking earlier of why I don't call this inner listening, and that what you're just talking about is a very good example, because some of it happens in what seems to be an external or something outside of us, like a tree or a bug or an animal. That's happened to me several times. The one that comes to mind most startling, and probably the first time I was really in contact with this, was in when I was on this trip in Europe back in the 80s, early 80s, I had gone with a gal, a very lovely young lady that wanted to accompany me. I thought we were going to spend 7 months together, maybe we'd end up the rest of our lives.
Glorious bliss.
Yeah. Yes, I had it all worked out then. I knew everything. I knew the answers then. The more I listen, the less I know, which is fine. Anyway, after 30 days, she decided that this was not for her, that she did not like living moment by moment, not knowing where we were going to be next, and she had better things to do, and she left me to return to the United States. I actually wasn't disappointed. I was quite glad she left, because I figured that my inner guide was going to arrange for me to have someone else. He certainly wouldn't send me to Europe for 7 months with enough stuff for two people, sleeping bags and tent and everything, if I was going to be alone. So I literally spent the next 30 days waiting for someone to show up and did all I could to help that along. I went to places where there would be people. Unfortunately, I was in France, and I got D's in college in my French, and I could barely get fed, let alone have any kind of a conversation with anybody.
Maybe I should go to France, too.
Well, it didn't work. Anyway, I ended up on this little island and after about 30 days, and I was feeling pretty sorry for myself, and I was sitting there having a little French wine and enjoying the sunset on this beautiful, called Ile de Ré. There's now a bridge over there, but at the time there was only a ferry, and I had gotten on the ferry by mistake, I thought. And so I was sitting there feeling sorry for myself and asking my inner guide when we were going to meet my companion. And there was no dialogue, nothing was going on.
You weren't hearing anything?
Nothing. And he'd been talking all day. Everything I'd ask about, I'd hear something. So nothing was going on. And as I sat there, these birds started flying, and they would fly right up to my face. It wasn't just like they were, you know, darting around like swallows under your feet. They would come right up to my face like this and turn, and it was quite startling.
Did they look anything like Jonathan Livingston Seagull?
No, they were small birds. Anyway, I said, they kept doing it. I said, what are these crazy birds doing? Was not a question I expected to be answered. It was more of
a flippant
thought. Yeah. What's this all about? And my inner guide said, they're making love to you. And that really stopped me.
I guess that
was something I was looking forward to, but not with a bird, actually.
Darn.
But
it has to be a bird.
Anyway, I thought, well, you know, it's possible. I had a cat that when I was going through some of my really sorrowful times would come and sit beside me, and then when I felt better, he'd leave, and he wouldn't have anything to do with me. You know, he was just kind of on his own. I thought he sensed when I needed company. Maybe these birds are sensing the same thing. So I thought, I got nothing better to do. I'll just sit here and try not to duck and try not to be afraid of them. Let them do what they're doing. And as I accepted them, they didn't say anything to me, but I could feel really their compassion and their company. And watch them. It was quite startling to watch them fly right up to me and tried not to duck. And as I let them do that, the bushes and the trees and everything started sending out this love. I can't explain it to you. It was almost a radiation. I could literally see it. The closest thing I can describe it as is the when you're in the desert or when you see a mirage, it was sort of that shimmering.
That wavy.
Yeah, things lost their hard form and started shimmering like that. And I could feel this love, and I thought, my God, the world is made of love. I mean, if there's such a thing as electrons or protons, they're probably really love. I mean, they're not physical, they're love.
I'm getting chills.
It was amazing. It was amazing. The next thought was, all my life, the one thing I really wanted out of life was love. I've been wandering around in a world made of love, trying to find love.
Blind
I felt like the biggest idiot. And the next thought was, why haven't I found it? Why, if I'm wandering in a world made of love, why haven't I seen this before? And
looking for love in all the wrong places?
Yeah, the thought was, you've decided what love would look like. You've decided what form it would come in. And at this point, I'd narrowed that form down to pretty well defined as so tall, blonde hair, and so forth. I felt that I'd boxed myself in. I could see myself sitting in this walled castle. Every time I'd had a bad experience, I'd say, well, I don't want that, I don't want that, I don't want that. I'd really eliminate all the possibilities. I'm waiting for love to show up with no possibility of the form for it to show in. And the next thought was, the only thing that could get into this castle would be a bird. And but my feeling of gratitude to these birds was just unbelievable. So I said, okay, I'm dying in here. I'm literally starving for love. And I'm going to open up tomorrow. And I don't care where it comes from, birds, trees, old people, children, I don't care. I just want love in any form. I'm not going
to
decide.
Doesn't have to be a woman.
Didn't have to be a woman. No, it was wonderful. the next day I can really say, everybody says that my life changed. It really did. The contrast was so fantastic from really wandering around alone looking to just opening to it from everyone, and all of a sudden people are talking to me and buying me coffee and wanting me to stay at their house and
being nice to you.
It was fantastic. Even for 2 days there was a little monkey that would run over and give me hugs every time she saw me. The owners kept apologizing. I said, don't apologize, it's great. A female monkey, by the way.
As you were saying that, I just noticed this bird fly by the window.
Oh.
I've
also been very aware, sometimes when I'm really making contact with something, there will be a bird fly over or fly around. Animals are very sensitive to the to that connection, and they have a lot to share with us. And there's other stories I won't bore you with, but a fly, as a matter of fact, in Australia, the flies are quite prevalent.
I'm bored.
They're quite prevalent. And I was having problems with them when I was there, and finally one who I'd been swatting and ducking and everything came and sat on the rearview mirror. Well, first he sat inside the right next to the window I had down, and he just started looking at me, and I, instead of shooing him away, I started looking back, and the thought was, why are you so afraid of me? Why are you trying to kill me? I'm the one that should be afraid, and I'm not afraid. And he drove with me for quite a while, and I felt this that he had a purpose there. In fact, they are the scavengers. They're the ones that clean up. Mm-hmm. And if I would only just relax with him, that he would not disturb me. And in fact, I shared it with some other people in Australia, and we were actually working in a garden one day, and as we could really release our fear and our anger with flies disturbing us, they literally went away. So there's some amazing experiences out there.
So we really are living in a singular consciousness.
Yeah, we are. We are.
Even though we have our individual identities.
Individual manifestation of that consciousness. And everything is at this level of being. But we are all connected, and there's nothing that is not a part of that manifestation, even if it's manufactured a chair or camera is part of that. And on some level, we all know that because we give things names and we talk about her, our car, or him, or things like that. It is that feeling of connection. There's nothing but God, and I don't mean God out there as a person, but consciousness manifesting. Whether I create it out of my consciousness as of a table or whether it's a tree, and we need to really broaden to that. And if we do, we really get all the wonder out of it. In fact, a tree for me is fantastic because a tree is really unconditional love. I mean, it will give shade and shelter to anyone. It allows you to cut it down and use it for firewood. Mm-hmm. It sprouts up again and grows anew and replenishes itself. It's a fantastic consciousness. The trees are, and water, and on and on.
I had that experience about a year ago. A friend of mine is good at facilitating and helping people get in touch with nature. And we went out and we're hugging a tree.
Yeah. Know? Yeah,
and she challenged me to tell the group what the tree was saying, and it was a very similar message as you just said. And I was crying, and it was a beautiful experience. Mm-hmm. It was as if I was really talking to a consciousness, a personality, this particular tree.
Oh yeah,
it was.
Oh yeah,
it was a feeling of oneness at the same time. Michael Rhodes had some of these experiences too with cows.
Yeah.
He used to go in the barn and milk the cows, and before he was into the higher consciousness, the cows would swat him with their tails, and they would poop on him, and they'd swat him with their tail with the poop on it. And he was getting more and more frustrated. And eventually he got so mad, he picked up this big wrench, and he was going to slug this cow with a wrench.
Yeah.
And somehow, in the moment that he was swinging, the cow's tail came around, grabbed that wrench, and it ended up hitting him in the arm. So he was so injured, he had to go and lie in bed for a number of days. And during that time of quietude, he realized it was his own attitude that was coming back to him through
much.
The cows.
Very much.
And that his wife never had that experience. Yeah. She'd go into the barn and she was fine, you know. So after that, they started communicating with the cows. And they would say, well, at 2 o'clock, we want the cows to go from this pasture, from this place to that place. And they would go automatically.
Yeah.
And then he started having all these experiences of harmony instead of the dysfunctional pushiness that I think we all sort of get into in our everyday lives.
There's a wonderful book called Kinship with All Life about this too. That, and the point in the book there that really was meaningful to me, that stop looking at ourselves as superior beings and meet other consciousness on the same plane if you want to get the message.
I'm with Lee Coit, who I happened to be lucky enough to grab on a stopover here in Evanston, Illinois, on his way to Michigan. And I have in front of me your first book, Listening. And right at the beginning of the first chapter, you say that your true potential is as close as your inner thoughts and as bright as the most creative insight. This exists in all of us, and when it finds expression, it is called genius.
Right.
Where did that come from? What's that about?
Well, probably came from some of the information that's been given to me about how geniuses came about and what happens. And basically, Mozart's a wonderful example.
Mm-hmm.
It comes when people really let go of their restrictions on what they think is right and so forth. In fact, Amadeus is a wonderful movie about inner listening and how it works and how it flows free. And Solari is how to do it with the human way to really work on it. You know everything about it and you write it all down and you work really hard. And what drove Solari, I guess I'm saying his
Who's
name right.
Who's Solari?
Solari was the fellow that hated Mozart.
Oh, okay.
Loved him and hated him.
Okay.
At the same, maybe I'm not saying his name. Maybe it's Solari or something. But
that's
anyway, he was the king's, major musician, and this was upstart was Mozart, who acted stupid and very childlike in public, and was very socially not
embarrassing.
Yeah, and did these terrible things. But somehow Solari felt there was something there for him, so he kind of, it was a love-hate relationship on his part. But what really drove him crazy was when he saw that Mozart wrote his music without changes. I mean, he was just like he was listening to it and writing it down.
Channel it.
Yeah, and here Solari was like struggling. It's really the two ways to go. The interesting thing about this whole subject of material, spiritual, inner guidance, doing it yourself, is we tend to subscribe good and bad. If you're doing it spiritually, that makes it good, and if you're doing it materially, that makes it bad. And those terms really don't apply. And there's a time in our life that we need to go through all the material steps. You can't just jump over it. If you ever jump over it, you'll go back and repeat it. You have to really find out what material is about.
Isn't that sort of the prodigal son story?
It's the prodigal son story, exactly. Mm-hmm.
We have to experience the material world in separation.
Exactly.
In order to appreciate, perhaps. Is that right?
To appreciate it, and actually the word that I've been given, which it describes it, to want nothing else. You see, he had everything before he left. The prodigal son had everything.
That's
but
right.
He left to experience the world, to do it on his own. He didn't want to be under his father's direction and so forth. He wanted to do it on his own. He failed. He could just as easily have succeeded. He would still be the same result. He would realize, either through success or failure, that he didn't have everything he had when he was with his father. And so he would want to come back. The difference is, and the reason that process is important, is when he comes back, his attitude is now entirely different. In the beginning, it was just a gift. He took it for granted. It was something he got without
it.
Yeah, he couldn't appreciate it. When he came back, he tried everything else, and now he saw the value of it, you see. So the material process, is what gives us a sense of value. Making it our own, individualizing it for us so we want it, not just because it's given to us and it's a neat deal, but we want it because we know it's best. We've made a decision, an active decision. The only thing that's wrong with the material world, you can call it a world of illusion, call it anything you want.
Maya,
it,
like
it,
the Eastern
basically,
philosophers.
Basically, is that it's limited. And that's the test. It will only last for a period of time, and it has limited ability to satisfy us. And when you think about this, even philosophically, that's why it has form. You see, form is an outline or a containment of an idea. It limits the idea to that particular shape. Take a tree, for example. A tree is not really a tree. We call it a tree, and we only look at the part that's above the ground and the leaves and the branches and so forth. But that's not the tree. If you dug it up, it couldn't live like that. It's the roots, but it's not just the roots. It's mm-hmm. the ground, and it's the soil underneath
and
that,
the air,
and it's the rocks underneath that. It's clear down to the magma, and it's all the worms and all the other things that are involved, and the bugs and the leaves and the squirrels and the sky and the sun and on out into the universe. So a tree really, though we box it in a limited concept in order to talk about it, is not limited. I mean, it could not survive, it could not have life were it not connected with the whole. And we're all like that. Everything is interrelated. But what we try to do in a material sense, what causes the illusion or the misperception, is that we try to box it. We try to put it into containers. You see, and when we put something in a container, we deal with it not as it really is, but we deal with it as it is in a limited sense. Since we're spiritual beings and we're unlimited, nothing limited will ever truly satisfy us. But we have to go through the limited idea or the limited individualization of something to find out that it doesn't satisfy us.
Yes.
You see? It's really very simple.
But that's profound.
It's not complicated at all. And that's why nothing ever really changes. All that changes when you reach this nirvana or awareness or enlightenment or whatever you call it, nothing really changes.
You still have to chop wood and carry
you
water.
You realize that the tree isn't limited to just the shape. Mm-hmm. That's all that happened. You see all the interconnection. You see all the relationship. You see the entire picture, not just a little portion of it.
You've just opened up.
That's right.
To the infinite.
That's right. You've just realized what was always there. And you become aware of what was always there. So it's just really like opening the drapes and seeing the whole view rather than looking out through one little crack and saying, that's it. But nothing has changed. You haven't changed, nor the view hasn't changed. You see? Everything's the same. And if we really think about that as being limited or unlimited, we can really see where the battlefield, if you want to say, is. And that's to remove the limitations from our own mind, to stop seeing certain things as wrong, certain people as wrong, certain places as superior or inferior.
Judgment.
Yeah.
And
it's
Christ,
not, judgment
rails
is not
on,
bad.
On judgment quite
yeah,
a bit.
Judgment's not wrong. Judgment's not bad. Judgment just limits our viewpoint.
It only hurts ourselves.
Right. We only separate ourselves. When we try to limit the unlimited, we separate ourselves from the total picture. And we say, I'm only going to deal with this one little part down here. And we have to do that for a while because we think this little part is special, whatever it is. But eventually, if we either it fails us or we get all of it, we see this is not enough. I want more. Because we're unlimited beings, we will always eventually go to the unlimited. Now, genius, all of us are unlimited. We're not becoming unlimited. We are unlimited. We're just becoming aware of it. Mm-hmm. Genius is merely those moments when we don't try to limit our awareness. So with Mozart, all that was happening, his childlike, his whole attitude towards life allowed him not to be constrained by what was at that point thought of as music. At that point, the only music there was the Italian music done in a certain way. Nothing wrong with it. It's not bad music, but it was limited. And what Mozart did was to open it all up. What Einstein did was to really open up the idea of dimensions. There's not just three dimensions, there's more.
Right.
So it's always, genius is always an expansion, an unlimited realization of what's there. And that's possible in all of us. If you think of your own self, the moments when you felt inspired, I'm getting excited about this, but it's so beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
When we get inspired, all we've done is really open to all the possibilities. we can start that process just by being more open-minded, or as you're saying, Steve, less judgmental, less willing to constrict things, at least question that maybe there's more there than what we see, maybe there's more there than what we know, and be open to the possibilities.
Yeah. Well, you read my mind. I was going to ask you how we do that with just a short time remaining. I want to thank you, Lee, for taking the time for this interview. I want to wish you the best on your travels. And in the remaining few moments, if anyone would like to get in touch with you to arrange for an engagement, mm-hmm. how would they do that?
I'm living at the time in California. In the town where I get my mail is Wildomar, and it's just like Wild Omar, Wildomar, Wildomar, California, and P.O. Box 500, and the zip code there is 92595. And just to write to me, and if you can't find the books or tapes in your bookstore, why, I can send them out to you. Happy to come and talk to small groups. I'm not looking for large venues. If that happens, that's fine too. But I'm really mostly interested in people that want to know more about the process. And if they're interested, I'm interested.
I want to thank you, Lee. I've had just the most marvelous time, and I've had an inner experience just listening. So thank you.
Thank you, Steve.